those walls that we called sin and shame. They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Death and grave, they were like mountains that stood in our way. But he came and he died and he rose. Those giants are dead now. This is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus. Remember that fear that took our breath away. Faith so weak that we could barely pray.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Plymouth Alliance Church. Would you stand and worship with us?
You are the only king forever, Almighty God. forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore. You are victorious.
Amen. You guys can take a seat. Welcome to Plymouth Alliance again, everybody. My name is Anders. I'm the Associate Pastor for Student Ministries here. And we are so glad that you decided to join us for worship. If you're new with us, we'd love it if you fill out a Let's Connect card. It helps us get to know more about you. It helps you get to know more about us. If you're new with us or if you've been here for a while and there are ways that we can pray for you, we would love to pray for you. If there are ways that God has done a work, if he's done really cool things in your life and we could rejoice with you, we want to do that as well. Both the Let's Connect card and the prayer card can be found in the back of the seat in front of you. Will you guys pray with me for this morning's offering? Lord, we love you. We pray that you would use our tithes and our offerings to bring glory to yourself, Lord. Would you do a work here in Plymouth? Would you do a work around the world to advance your kingdom for your glory? Your name, amen.
Amen.
So last week we learned a song that we're gonna do again. It's called Praise His Name. It's straight out of Psalm 148. The words will be on the screen, or a fun thing is you can just open your Bible to Psalm 148 because it's there.
Of heaven, starry light, light of the evening, dancing in silent skies, brilliance of morning, breaking day.
Stand and sing with us. Oh,
Good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone.
Mm-hmm.
nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Can take a seat, and as you do, PAC Kids are dismissed for Children's Church.
Thank you. Has God ever left you hanging? Have you ever cried out to him for help and gotten nothing in response? And I'm not talking about when you asked for a new PlayStation under the tree or for a promotion that would double your salary and triple your vacation time. I'm talking about a loved one who's really sick and needs help. I'm talking about when that relationship is strained and is in danger of snapping. I'm talking about when you don't know how you're going to provide for your family because your job situation is in flux. I have been a part of this church for almost 20 years, and in that time I have seen God answer those kinds of prayers. He has healed, he has restored, he has provided. Scripture gives us numerous examples of him doing that. And we read things like Psalm 46 that says he is a refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Or 2 Corinthians 12 that says, my grace is sufficient for you. So of course, God would never not be there when we need him. But has God ever left you hanging? Have you ever cried out to him for help and not gotten anything? Not so much as a response, much less fixing the problem. Has he ever not even brought a scripture verse to mind at just the right moment, or a friend to stop by and encourage you? Has he ever left you with absolute and utter silence? Some of you, although you aren't doing it physically, are nodding along with me right now. You have been there, or you know someone who's been there, or maybe you're there right now. Others might be bothered a little bit by this notion. It doesn't match what you know of God, that he would leave someone hanging. And so you're paying extra careful attention, sitting up a little straighter. And be honest, there's a couple of you out there wondering why Pastor Pete agreed to let this guy preach. If the premise that God would leave someone hanging bothers you, let me say that it might be that when God has left us hanging, it only seems or feels like he has left us hanging. It could be that because of sin and selfishness and living in a fallen and messy world, our perception of reality is a little clouded, and so we're not seeing things accurately. Or it could be that we don't have a real good understanding of God's word. Maybe we've never really studied it. Maybe we've just taken somebody else's word for it. Maybe we have taken verses out of context and made them mean things they don't really mean. That said, there are times, and I have biblical support for this, there are times when God will leave us hanging, when he will answer us with absolutely nothing but silence. This morning we're going to look at two people in Scripture who experienced that. They call out to God for help, and he doesn't fix the problem, he doesn't even respond. And we're going to draw some observations as we look at this passage, but before we do that, I want to issue a caveat. God is not a math formula. If we look at how he worked in one situation and think it's an exact pattern we can apply to our situation, we're going to get ourselves into trouble at times. But God doesn't change. He is the same. And his character never changes. And so these observations will show us who he is and where his heart lies and how he might be working. I would say how he is likely to be working in those moments when he has left us, or it seems like he has left us hanging. If you've got a Bible, please turn with me to the book of John, chapter 11. If you don't have one, there is a Bible under the chair in front of you or in front of your neighbor. Whoever's faster gets the Bible. We're not going to read the whole passage this morning. It's a familiar story and it's a long passage, but I am going to keep referring to it, so I encourage you to have your Bible open. John 11 tells us the story of a man named Lazarus, but today we're looking at the story of his sisters, Mary and Martha. And in the first couple of verses, we read that Lazarus is sick. Mary and Martha know who Jesus is. They know what he has done, and they cry out to God for help. Please save our brother's life. What does Jesus do? Look at the text. He doesn't even bother to pack. He just slips on his sandals and hurries to Bethany, places his hands on Lazarus, and says, "Be well." And Lazarus sits up, blinks a few times, and asks, "What's for dinner?" That's not what it says, is it? Nor does Jesus send word back to the sisters saying, "Don't worry, I'm going to come and fix everything. It'll be all right. Just be patient." He doesn't even send word to say, "I'm really sorry. I know this must be hard for you. I'll be there to comfort you." What is Jesus' response? Verse 6. He stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Now, we might know the end of the story, but remember, we're looking at this from Mary and Martha's perspective. In that moment, they had cried out to God for help, and he did nothing. He left them hanging without a solution and without so much as a response to their plea. They had to watch as the situation deteriorated, and Lazarus went from sick to dead. Again, I ask, have you been there? Are you there now? Has God left you hanging? We're going to draw 5 observations from this passage, and the first is found in verses 3 and 5, where we read that Jesus loved Lazarus and his sisters. Now, you might be thinking that's not exactly a newsflash. Observation 1 is that God loves us. But think for a moment about someone that you really love, and suppose they're really sick. And I don't mean terminally, I mean food poisoning, and they're puking their guts up. Or they've got one of those colds where they're just thoroughly congested, can't breathe, achy, miserable. Or think of a little kid who fell and scraped his knee or bumped her head. If you, loving that person as you did, had the power, with a snap of your fingers, a wave of your hand, or merely by your word to fix the problem and make their pain go away, wouldn't you do so? You see, we equate God loving us with God not allowing us to suffer. And then conversely, if he allows us to suffer, does that mean he doesn't love us? Now, we might not ever think it that overtly, and we certainly wouldn't admit it to anyone if we did, but deep inside, we start to ask the question, if I'm suffering, does that mean that God doesn't love me? Friends, that is a lie from the devil. If we believe the Bible to be God's word, we have a clear contradiction of that lie in John 11. We're told that Jesus loved Mary and Martha, and yet they were clearly allowed to suffer as they saw Lazarus get sick, get sicker, and die, and have Jesus do nothing when they called out for help. When you're suffering, please don't fall for the lie that God does not love you. We don't always understand why he allows us to walk through the valley. It may not make sense to us, but Scripture tells us that God's loving us and his allowing us to suffer are not mutually exclusive. The Bible doesn't merely tell us of God's love, however, it shows his love. In verse 7, and again in verses 11 and 15, Jesus proposes going to Lazarus in Judea. Rabbi, the disciples protest in verse 8, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and are you going there again? What is Jesus' response? Good point. I actually don't need to be there. I transcend time and space. Lazarus is healed remotely. No, again, that's not his response. He goes to Bethany, into the heart of danger. Now, you could argue that Jesus wasn't in any real immediate danger. Several times in Scripture, we read that people tried to harm him, and he eluded them because his time had not yet come. But what about when his time had come? In Luke 9, Jesus twice predicts his death. And then in verse 51, we read, when the days were approaching for his ascension, he was determined to go to Jerusalem. The NIV says he set out resolutely. Pastor Pete referenced this a few weeks ago. The idea is of him gritting his teeth, setting his jaw in absolute determination to go to Jerusalem and face his brutal torture and death. We see the same determination in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus prays, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, but then not my will, but yours be done. We see it in him going to the cross for us and dying in our place. Pain and suffering and hardship never deterred Jesus. Such was his love. Such is his love for you and me. Never doubt God's love for you, because he showed it to you in the most dramatic of fashions. Jump back to John 11, verse 4, and we'll see our second observation. Jesus said, this sickness is not to end in death. Please note, he doesn't say this sickness is not to involve death. He says this sickness is not to end in death. Some of you know that I am a self-published author. I write action and adventure novels, which stems from my desire to watch action movies and read adventure novels. And a few years ago, to get some inspiration, I went to see the latest Mission Impossible in the theater. And I left having experienced something I'd never experienced before, and that for 2.5 hours, I was on the edge of my seat. Well, technically, I was splayed out in their recliner loungers with my feet up and popcorn all over my shirt and everything, but figuratively, I was on the edge of my seat the whole movie because it was constantly at a climax. It was full of excitement and energy and anxiety and uncertainty. How was everything going to turn out? Would Tom Cruise save the day? Would all his friends survive? That's why I write, because I want to try to create that same sort of feeling. But when I'm writing a novel and I come to the climax, to that do or die moment when everything hangs in the balance, I'm never anxious or nervous. There's very little excitement. You could argue I'm not a very good writer. I like to think it's because I know how the story plays out. And nothing is going to happen to my characters if I don't allow it to happen. Jesus was fully human. And in places in Scripture, we read that he learned things or found things out. But Jesus was also fully divine and often looked into people's hearts and knew what they were thinking. In this case, the omniscience, that is the all-knowing nature of God, was on display, and he knew that Lazarus' sickness would not end in death. It didn't catch him off guard. It didn't make him nervous or uncertain. Just like the diagnosis from the doctor didn't make him anxious. Just like the factory layoff wasn't a surprise to him. Just like the news that your teenage daughter is pregnant isn't news to him. God knows the end. More than that, he's in control of the end. Now, we have to be careful here. I don't believe the Bible teaches that God is a giant puppet master pulling billions of strings and causing every single thing that happens to happen. Unlike the characters in my books, you and I have free will and we can make our own choices. But God is in control. We see this in the book of Job, where the devil comes before Job and is only allowed to bring hardship and harm upon Job once God lifts his hand of protection and allows it. Now, we could spend hours, ask my men's Bible study if you don't believe it, we could spend hours discussing the interplay between the sovereignty of God and the free will of man. But wherever we fall on that spectrum, one thing is clear: God is in control, and nothing has happened, is happening, or can happen if he does not allow it to. And while that doesn't provide us the answer to the question of why, it should bring us comfort to know that someone who loves us as much as God does is in control of our situation. God loves us, and our second observation is that God knows and is in control of the end game. And that leads right into observation number 3, which is found in the second half of verse 4. This sickness is not to end in death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by it. My sister was due to give birth to her 7th child this coming week. But on March 16th, she wasn't feeling the baby moving the way she wanted to, thought she should. So she went into the hospital, and that evening, my nephew Elijah was delivered via emergency C-section. 2 days later, they took him down to the NICU in Madison because he was having some issues with his bowels and intestines and things weren't progressing the way they should. And he is still in the NICU. They're still trying to get his food levels up. There's surgery likely in his future to fix the problem. And on Good Friday, we got the news that Elijah has Down syndrome. And so for the past month, my family's been going through a whirlwind of emotions and a lot of logistics, travel back and forth and trying to figure things out. I have been doing an awful lot of praying, and some of you, aware of the situation, have been praying, for which I thank you. And I bring all of this up because as I've been praying a lot for Elijah the last month, I have not spent a lot of time praying for the glory of God. I have been praying for Elijah to get better. I have been praying for my family. I think that's normal. I think most of you can probably relate. Our natural response is not to seek God's glory when we face a hardship or a struggle. But I have to say, having been a part of this church, as I said, for 20 years, and being an elder now for 7 years, I've had a chance to pray with many of you and to pray for many of you. And there has been a consistent theme as you have asked that God would heal and restore and provide. You have asked that God would be glorified. And you have asked that he would be glorified even if it meant not fixing your particular problem. That is an incredible testament to faith, and I commend you for it, because as I can attest to, that is not easy. That is not natural. Romans 8:28 is a Bible verse that is far too often used tritely or dismissively or turned into a slogan. But Romans 8:28 is biblical truth. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. We like to read that and read the word good and think it means tangible benefits, that God is going to make everything better, like he did for Job, bigger houses and more money and better relationships than we had at first. And our gracious God may do just that. But often the good he is working toward is eternal good, is spiritual good. Look at John 11, 14 and 15. Lazarus is dead, and I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, so that you may believe. Remember, Jesus is talking to his disciples here. Mary and Martha have no knowledge of this. But imagine that you're them, and Jesus has just said to you, I'm glad your brother is dead. Talk about a relationship that would need some restoration. But the why is so important. I am glad for your, that is the disciples' sakes, that I was not there, so that you may believe. Now think of your situation. Like Mary and Martha, you have no knowledge of what's going on behind the scenes, but suppose God came to you and said, I'm glad you're struggling with anxiety and depression. I'm glad you're being bullied. I'm glad you're watching all your friends get married and have kids, and you're still single or unable to conceive. I'm glad your nephew has Down syndrome. That might be enough to make you start to question the goodness of God. But suppose he came and gave you the reason so that others might believe. Again, I don't know that that's the case. God is not a math formula. But you may be going through what you're going through so that someone else will come to faith in Jesus Christ, or that someone else will have their faith strengthened, or will be buoyed in their trials because of your testimony during yours. That doesn't make the pain go away. I get it. I thought I'd be speaking theoretically this morning. Instead, I'm speaking from real experience. That doesn't make the pain go away. But knowing that God is working, or it shows us, I should say, how God is working. And if we are in line with him, that working is for our good, just not in the way we might think. You see, if we're truly having the mindset that God wants us to have, we should always be thinking about his glory. You're a high school athlete who just won state. How can God be glorified in that? You just got that promotion you've been asking for, and it does mean more money and a much nicer parking space, too. How can God be glorified in that? The prettiest girl in the whole school just agreed to go out with you. How can God be glorified in that? That's not natural. We have to train ourselves to think that way. But here's the kicker. It works the other way, too. You just found out you didn't make the team. You just got passed over for that promotion, and they're going to bump you to a less desirable shift. The prettiest girl in the whole school and her A-list friends want nothing to do with you. How can God be glorified in that? The truth is, we don't always know, but we do know that God is working for our good, a good that may include tangible benefits, that may include his fixing the problem, as he did for Job, but it might also be a good that is realized when we put our desires and attitudes in tune with his, a good that might not be realized until we stand in glory before him and beside someone whose life was impacted by his working in our trials. God loves us. God knows the outcome. Our third observation is that God is working for his glory. And now the scene changes in John. Now Jesus arrives in Bethany. Now we see him interact with both Mary and Martha. And at first we seem to get a similar interaction. Martha comes out in verse 21 and says, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. A little while later, in verse 32, when Mary comes out to the place where Jesus was, she says the same thing. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Unfortunately, we're not told how they said it. Was Mary gasping and sobbing as she fell to her feet? Was she absolutely gutted? Did Martha scream it? Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died? Guilty confession, I have yelled at God before. We don't know how they said it. Scripture doesn't overtly tell us. So we have to do a little bit of detective work. And to do that, we're going to look at Jesus' responses to the two women. We'll start with his response to Mary. In verse 32, she says, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. In verse 33, we read, when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled. And then we read in the next couple of verses that they brought him to the tomb and Jesus wept. And we might be tempted to just kind of gloss over those verses and think Jesus was really sad, and who wouldn't be? But ask yourself the question, why is Jesus sad? He knows, and spoiler alert if you haven't read ahead, he knows that in 5 minutes Lazarus is going to walk out of that tomb alive. Mary and Martha and the mourners are going to experience the greatest joy of their life. I wouldn't be weeping, I would be holding back a smirk. Just wait until you see what I am about to do. Why is Jesus weeping? Could it be that he is a sympathetic crier? I don't mean that tritely. The Bible says rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep or mourn with those who weep or mourn. Mary and Martha are weeping. Jesus is weeping with them. Yeah, I think that could be part of it. Could it be that he's grieving the pain and death that have influenced the world, that were not part of God's design, and he's weeping on behalf of humanity? Yeah, that might play into it as well. But if we look at verse 33 to that phrase, deeply moved in spirit, and if we take a moment to look at the original Greek, we see there's a lot more going on with Jesus' emotions and his response. That phrase, deeply moved in spirit, is translated from the Greek embrameomai, which means to have indignation or to blame. Helps Word Study says that it means to snort like an angry horse, or to snort or roar with rage. According to Strong's Concordance, it expresses strong indignation, a deep feeling that is moved to sternly admonish. And the word troubled right after it carries with it a connotation of being agitated, of being stirred up. This is not the somber, long-faced Jesus we see in pictures. He is not merely sad. He is embrameomai. Why? We see this Greek word used five times in the New Testament. Once here, once in Matthew 9 and Mark 1, where Jesus healed people and sternly warned them not to tell anyone about it. Once again in Mark 14, where the woman who anointed Jesus was rebuked by the disciples for what they saw as a waste of perfume. And once again in John 11, five verses down in verse 38. So Jesus, again being deeply moved within, embrameomai, came to the tomb. I ask again, why is Jesus angry? Look back at verse 37. But some of them said, could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man also from dying? And look at Mary in verse 32. If you had been here, my brother would not have died. Period. End of statement. And now contrast that with Martha back in verse 21. If you had been here, my brother would not have died. Even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. The Greek has a but there, but even now. That's a word of contrast that gives us insight into Martha's perspective. Look at Jesus' response to her in verse 23. He says, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even if he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of God, even he who comes into the world. That phrase, I have believed, is in the present tense, which is used to describe an action completed in the past, but carrying on and having impact to the present time. Martha, despite her sorrow, her brokenness, despite not understanding why Jesus responded the way he did and didn't respond the way he didn't, still exercised faith. She saw Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God. She believed that he was the resurrection and the life, and therefore that Lazarus would rise again at the last day. But her faith didn't stop there. Even now, even with Lazarus in the tomb, it was not too late for the Son of God to work. Mary's expression of faith stopped at what Jesus could have done. The mourners with her believed in Jesus to a limited capacity. He could heal sick people, but once they died, it was all over. Now, hold on a second, some of you might be thinking. Are you telling me that Jesus was snorting mad because they didn't expect him to raise Lazarus from the dead? That does seem a little harsh. I've been to a lot of funerals, as I'm sure many of you have, and I have never once gone with the expectation that halfway through the service, the deceased would sit up in the casket and then climb out and join us for refreshments in the foyer. Is God, any of you? Is God angry with me for that lack of faith? I don't think so, because I think the issue here is not that Mary and her fellow mourners doubted that Jesus would raise Lazarus from the dead, but they doubted that he could raise Lazarus from the dead. And thus they had lost hope. So now think of our sufferings and our moments when it seems God has left us hanging. And I pose the question to you, and I pose it right back to myself. Have we lost hope because we believe in a limited capacity Jesus? We have a problem, and we ask for a fix according to certain parameters. Let it not be cancer. Let the mandate not cost me my job. Let so-and-so not win the election. Because if he doesn't fix it according to those parameters, we'll be sunk. And if it is cancer, if I do lose my job, if so-and-so wins the election, if Lazarus dies, well, there's nothing anyone can do. If this hits a little close to home, you're in good company. I am too often guilty of this kind of thinking. But friends, we serve a God who is the God of there's nothing anyone can do. I don't like a lot of contemporary Christian music, but I am a fan of Lauren Daigle. Something in her voice and her tone and the style of her music hits a frequency that my ears appreciate, and more than that, many of her lyrics hit the right frequency too. Take, for example, a song off the album Look Up Child. In the darkest hour when I cannot breathe, fear is on my chest, the weight of the world on me. Everything is crashing down, everything I had known. When I wonder if I'm all alone, I remember, you have always been faithful to me. I remember, even when my own eyes could not see, you were there, always there. What's so great about this song is that it's evocative of something we see throughout the Old Testament. When God says to the Israelites, remember, I delivered you from bondage in Egypt. Remember, I brought you through the Red Sea as on dry ground. Remember, I provided manna in the wilderness for 40 years. Remember, I brought you into the promised land. Remember, I defeated your enemies again and again and again. Remember, remember, remember. God does not call the Israelites to remembrance so that they can sit around the campfire smiling and laughing and living up the good old days. He does it to evoke faith in them for the current moment. Remember all that I have done and have faith in me again. Now, I have never walked through a parted body of water. I have never seen my supper fall from the sky. I have never seen my enemies defeated by the mere stamping of feet and blowing of trumpets. But I've read about such things. And the same God who provided for the Israelites time and time again is the God we pray to in our darkest hour when everything is crashing down. He is the same God who has time and time again answered our prayers and healed and restored and provided and fixed. Again, God is not a math formula, but his character never changes and it never wavers. God loves us. God knows the outcome. God is working for his glory. And our fourth observation is that God calls us to faith and is worthy of that faith. Again, I'm not suggesting we should beat up Mary and the mourners, nor am I trying to instill in your mind a picture of an angry God snorting from heaven against you. Rather, I'm trying to point you and point me to the example of Martha, who had faith that saw to eternity, but also had faith in the here and now. I will lift my eyes even in the pain. Above all the lies, I know you can make a way. I have seen giants fall. I have seen mountains move. I have seen waters part because of you. I remember. I remember. You have always been faithful to me. I remember. I remember. We've examined Mary and Martha's experience and drawn observations that can help us when it seems that God has left us hanging. But there's one problem. Lazarus is still dead as a doornail. God has not fixed their problem. But as Paul Harvey would say, now the rest of the story. Verse 39, Jesus said, remove the stone. Martha, the sister of the deceased, said to him, Lord, by this time there will be a stench, for he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not say to you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they removed the stone. Then Jesus raised his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but because of the people standing around, I said it, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. The man who had died came forth, bound hand and foot with wrappings, and his face was wrapped around with a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Our fifth and final observation is that when God has left you hanging, he will not leave you hanging. Mary and Martha had to wait 4 days. You may have to wait 4 weeks, 4 months, 4 years, 4 decades, for the rest of your life. And I know that might sound kind of like you're at a timeshare presentation and the other shoe has just dropped. How much? To say that God is going to fix your problem, to say that God is going to fix your problem by taking you to heaven one day sounds kind of like a cop-out, right? I would love to stand up here and tell you that God's going to make everything spectacular in the here and now. You will never have another bout with depression. You will never have another bill due before the paycheck hits the bank. You will never be the last one picked or get left out again. But I can't do that, because the ultimate hope of the Christian faith is not rooted in the here and now. The ultimate hope of the Christian faith is rooted in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The good news of the gospel, in fact, the only thing that makes the gospel good at all, is that Jesus was nailed to a Roman cross, not as punishment for his sins, like every other person who was crucified, but as punishment for my sins and for your sins. And Scripture tells us that as darkness came over the land in the middle of the day, and not because of an eclipse, and as God the Father turned his face away as his holy wrath was poured out on the sinless Lamb, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me? We might put that, God, why have you left me hanging? If it stops there, if Jesus was truly left hanging on that cross, or more accurately, left in a tomb to rot, if God never came and fixed the problem, we are, as Paul wrote, of all men most to be pitied. We're living in a fairy tale. If Christ has not been raised, my preaching is vain. Your faith is also in vain. But it doesn't stop there, as we just celebrated a few weeks ago. Jesus knew the answer to the question of why he was left hanging, of why he was forsaken. He was left to finish the payment for sin. But he also knew that God would not leave him hanging, that he would not let his Holy One see decay. God raised Jesus from the dead. He walked out of that tomb. He is alive today, and because of that, and only because of that, we have hope. But there is a caveat. The Bible tells us that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. That is, he left Jesus hanging, forsaken on a cross. That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. You see, if we believe that we're good enough, or at least better than worst, or if we believe that because we were baptized in a church or belong to a church or are sort of affiliated with a church, we're okay, or if we believe that God would never send people to hell, certainly not a loving God, none of which are biblical ideas, by the way. If we believe any of those things, we're telling Jesus that he did this for nothing. It was a waste. But if we look at ourselves, and if we're honest and we admit that we are sinners, and that we fall woefully short of God's perfect standard, and that there's nothing we can do about it, but if we look to the cross, and if we look to Jesus, and we trust in his payment on our behalf, the Bible says we have the hope of eternal life. Not a wishful thinking sort of a hope, but a confident expectation, an assurance. The book of Revelation tells about that hope, that eternal life. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away." No more death. No more cancer. No more sickness. No more bullies. No more feuds. No more betrayals. No more broken relationships. No more debt. No more financial struggles. No more politics. No more problems of any kind, no more curse. Just perfect happiness and union with God for all of eternity. Jesus said to Martha in the midst of her grieving, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Then he asked her, do you believe this? Church, in the midst of your grief, your pain, your hardship, in those moments when God has left you hanging, do you believe this? Nate, when your nephew's in the NICU, facing an uncertain future, hardships, do you believe this? Then rest assured as you remember.
I can't stop thinking about your goodness. I can't stop thinking about your
Friends, I hope and pray that God will do for you what he did for Mary and Martha, that he'll bring your Lazarus back in this life, that he will fix your problem. But if he doesn't, Remember that God loves you. Remember that he knows and is in control of the end game. Remember that he is working for his glory and your good. Remember that he calls you to faith and is worthy of that faith. And rest assured as you remember that God will not leave you hanging because he left his son hanging in your place and in mine, and because he did not leave him hanging but raised him from the dead. Will you stand with me, please, as we close this morning in prayer? Heavenly Father, I come before you on behalf of those who are hurting, who are grieving, struggling, not getting an answer to prayer, who perhaps for a time you have denied a response. And I implore you, Lord, would you please work and move in their lives? Would you bring the healing, the restoration, the provision, the fix to the problem that they are seeking? But if your answer to that question and to their pleas and cries for help is no, or is silence, then remind us, please, that our hope is anchored on the other side, and it is anchored firmly and securely in the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Give us strength to endure through the struggle. We ask all of this in the magnificent and marvelous and matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed.